Makita LXT batteries are often recommended for DIY purposes as they have low voltage protection, but there's a lot of conflicting information out there as to whether or not this is true. So let's look at their electronics, perform some acupuncture, accidentally brick another battery, make a sketchy resistor, and find out what the truth is. I've only found three sources that have actually tested LXT batteries for low voltage cutoff. First is Project Farm, who tested a 5 amp hour and claims it cuts out at 12.5 volts, which is the recommended cutoff. Second is Sauron Makes, who tested a 5 and 6 amp hour and found them to not cut out until 8.4 volts, which is well below recommended cutoff. Third is Naloxes, who claims that there is no inbuilt cutoff and instead the battery signals the tool to stop. Naloxes even appears in the comments section of Sauron Makes' video and they get into an internet argument. So let's see who is the winner. We'll start by opening the battery up and seeing what it's capable of. The positive terminal of the cells runs through three fuses to the positive pin. The fuses are rated for 30 amps, so 90 amps total. These fuses have a heater element, which allows the BMS to burn the fuses. The main chip is from Renesas and is a monolithic BMS chip that combines a microcontroller and analog front end into one chip. It's quite an advanced chip that has cell balancing, high side n-channel MOSFET drivers, a dedicated fuse burning pin, and accurate current sensing. At the negative terminal, we see a parallel pair of 0.5 milliohm shunt resistors that are used to measure the current. Between the shunts and the negative pin is a high-powered MOSFET. It's only 0.45 milliohms and has a 550 amp rating, so the battery is capable of cutting power with this MOSFET, but let's find out what conditions make it cut out. We'll start with the tool to find out what this third pin does. At 20 volts supply, squeezing the trigger gives 12.4 volts on the third pin, but this decreases with supply voltage. To get the tool to run, the voltage on the third pin must be within 2 volts of the positive pin. This allowed voltage delta increases slightly as the supply voltage drops. The tool won't start if the main voltage is below 12.95 volts, but once started, it will continue down to 6 volts. So, using adapters on 3-pin Makita tools will over-discharge your batteries. However, star-protected 2-pin tools do have low voltage cutoff. This LED light cuts out at 13 volts, so it is safe to use with adapters. On the battery, this third slot actually has two separate pins. I've been calling them the D and S pin for deepest and shallowest. The S pin always reads the same voltage as the positive pin, and the D pin normally reads 0 volts. The hooked pin of the tool momentarily connects the S to the D pin, which wakes up the BMS, and the D pin outputs a voltage that is 0.6 volts below pack voltage. The D pin can be activated with as little as 0.9 volts. So the D pin is a signaling pin that will stay 0.6 volts below pack voltage, but will drop to zero when the battery wants the tool to stop. You can't really do anything directly with the D pin, as just 1 milliamp will make its voltage drop too much and stop the tool. However, the D-pin is in effect a MOSFET driver signal, so it is trivial to use it to switch power. Naloxus notes that some brushed Makita tools do exactly this. If the current is 510 milliamps or more, the D-pin will stay high forever. 500 milliamps or less will make the D-pin come back to zero after exactly 1 minute. Fortunately for my sanity, it is always 1 minute. The D-pin can also be activated by drawing current from the main power pins. It normally takes 5.01 amps to activate it, however you can reactivate it with just 520 milliamps if you do so within 60 seconds of the D-pin turning off. When we drain a 5 amp hour battery to empty at 7 amps, the internal MOSFET cuts the power at 12.5 volts, just as Project Farm saw. We also see that the D-pin drops 500 milliseconds before the MOSFET cuts the power. When we test on a 3-pin tool, the D-pin drops and the tool turns off before the MOSFET can. So Makita is only using this MOSFET as a backup in case the D-pin signaling doesn't work. When we drain at 4 amps, we see the D-pin go low at 12.5 volts, but the MOSFET doesn't turn off. It keeps going and eventually the MOSFET turns off at 8.4 volts, which is the same result as Sauron Makes. It turns out 5 amps is the threshold for changing between the 8.4 or 12.5 volt MOSFET cutoff. This is very strange behavior, and my best guess is that this is intended to put the battery into storage mode for shipping. In a 2-pin tool, the tool will cut off at 13 volts. In a 3-pin tool, the battery will signal to stop at 12.5 volts and the tool will cut out. So the only time this 8.4 volt cutoff will occur is when you drain it on a non-Makita device at less than 5 amps. When we look inside 1.5 and 3 amp hour batteries, we see that there are no large MOSFETs. Testing them shows that there is no low voltage cutout either, just a cutoff signal from the D pin. Strangely, the low voltage signal on the 1.5 and 3 amp hour occurs at 9 volts. This is a very low value and even lower than Milwaukee M18, which was 10 volts. This is definitely not a storage mode. Makita has intentionally programmed these batteries to run down to 9 volts on 3 pin tools. I have no idea why Makita has decided to out Milwaukee Milwaukee and also only with their cheaper batteries. So, Project Farm said 12.5 cutoff, Sauron Makes said 8.4, and Naloxes said only low voltage signalling. All of them were right on some aspects, but wrong on others. So, the winner of the internet argument is me. However, they each made important contributions, and that's how science works. I still don't have the full story, as I don't know what the 4 amp hour does. Now, what will the MOSFET do when we overheat or overload the battery? And will I manage to brick another battery in the pursuit of science? Makita's thermistor is not very accessible, so we have to do some acupuncture to get past the silicone. The BMS only turns on the thermistor for a very short interval, so we have to use a scope to see it. Unfortunately, I didn't realise that my scope leads have a common ground, so when I tried to measure across the terminals, I grounded the thermistor and made the BMS think the battery had experienced several hundred degrees Celsius. The BMS has now permanently locked this battery, although it didn't burn the fuses. I bought 3 more batteries and tried again. The 1.5 and 3 amp hour trigger over temp with 2.2 kiloohms, but the 5 amp hour needs 1 kiloohm. The 1.5 and 3 amp hour just turn off the D pin, whilst the 5 amp hour turns off the D pin and then cuts the MOSFET. I tested overcurrent with a scumbag variable resistor made out of a whole roll of Constantin wire, pliers, and a piece of copper. I was expecting cutoff at around 90 amps, as that's what the battery is fused for. Instead, I was able to hit 100 amps without anything happening, and cutout only occurred when the voltage sagged below 12.5 volts. This was pretty disappointing, as it means you could burn these fuses and brick your battery through normal use. The battery has very accurate current sensing and the ability to cut power, but for some reason they're not doing it. I don't understand why Makita would put a $9 MOSFET into their batteries and seemingly never use it. Finally, we need to apply our marketing wankometer. Makita says, "Star protection is communication technology that allows the tool and battery to monitor conditions and exchange data in real time to protect against overload, overdischarge, and overheating." I checked, and there is definitely no data exchange between tool and battery, unless you count a stop-go signal as data. So this is flat-out lies. If they just deleted 6 words, then it would be a very accurate statement. In summary, the 5 and 6 amp hour have their own protection MOSFET, which protects against low voltage and over temp. I'd still recommend using your own protection MOSFET to cover you when draining at less than 5 amps. There's also a good chance that the battery records how often the internal MOSFET gets triggered, and this may eventually make the battery brick itself or deny you warranty. The 1.5 and 3 amp hour do not have protection, just a stop-go signal on the third pin. So you will definitely need your own protection MOSFET for them. Fortunately, Makita has made it trivially easy for you, so you have no excuse for not doing it. The 4 amp hour and batteries from different time periods are still an unknown. If anyone out there has any 4 amp hour batteries, 5 or 6 amp hour batteries from before 2019, or 1.5 and 3 amp hour batteries from after 2017, then I'd love to hear what results you get.